Okay. White House Press Secretary Jay Carney responded, saying the president can do more than one thing at a time. He also commented on McConnell's invitation for the president to come to the Senate to hear why Republicans oppose tax cuts.
What the senator invited the president to do was to hear Senate Republicans restate their maximalist position. We know what that position is. And he also invited the president to hear what would not pass. That's not a conversation worth having. What we need to have is a conversation about what will pass.
Okay, they're really bickering here. Are they going to get to the point at some point? Meanwhile, former President Bill Clinton is weighing in on the debate in Washington. Talking to ABC News yesterday, he says he sees another path for compromise.
What I'd like to see him do is agree on the outlines of a 10-year plan and then agree not to start either the revenue hikes or the spending cuts until we've got this recovery underway.
It's nice of him.
Yeah.
How's that morning bun?
It's good. So, John, you have the president saying, being sort of derisive in his press conference, hey, they need to just stay in town. We need to work. We need to get this done. It's like recess. When my daughters have homework to do, they get it done a day early. Let's just stay here and work. See y'all later. I'm going to Philly. I got a fundraiser. Bye.
Yeah.
Well, no.
And, I mean, the imagery of that.
I'm not sure that's fair, Joe.
Why not?
Because he's the president. And they can all meet. And he was saying, you should have gotten this done. Let's get it done.
But his closest ally in the United States Senate, Dick Durbin, says we can't get anything done until the president gives us a framework. I mean, maybe he was writing the framework down on the back of cocktail napkins at the Philadelphia fundraiser. I can't imagine going to a fundraiser in the middle of a financial crisis.
Well, look, there's no question that the optics of this are not ideal, because the president did sort of just make this criticism, and now he has opened himself up to criticism back. The White House has a framework, and they had their own budget, and then in the negotiations that Joe Biden was taking part in, the White House had a framework that they were working off of. So it's not like they've not been providing guidance in the negotiations. I think the president's broad point, I think, to most Americans, if you looked at the schedules of the House and Senate over the course of the last couple months and over the course of the summer, where one body is in session and one body is out of session, doesn't look like a sane way to do business right now.
Especially if you're claiming we're really in an intense time.
Well, with a deadline coming up a month from now. And I think that's as a broad criticism. I think there are many members of the House and the Senate over the last couple of days who have said, this is we're not working in the most effective way possible to try to get this done. So I don't think the fact that the president's going to a fundraiser takes away the general point.
Is he going on vacation this 4th of July week?
I don't know how many days he's away. I doubt he's away all of next week.
We'll find out.
He was also a member of the Senate himself. I guess, Jeffrey, what's so distressing is the Republicans are pointing at the president. The president's pointing at the Republicans. Dick Durbin is saying we can't do anything until the president tells us what to do. And the White House and now is going back and forth trading barbs with Senate Republicans. What's happening? I mean, we've got to get this thing resolved.
This is a national breakdown that we're experiencing. I've just come back from 2 weeks of travel in Asia. I was in China. I was in the Middle East. I was in Europe. Nobody has politics like we have right now. And it's really not a matter of whether he's in Washington or not. Nobody's serious that we saw all the way through every one of those clips. No one's doing the slightest arithmetic. No one's actually looking at anything. This is a game, but it's a game for our country. And it's extremely weird, actually.
What's the president doing?
The president got off to the wrong start at the beginning of his administration with the wrong set of policies. He went in the wrong direction, opened up huge deficits. Then, last December, as we know, with these looming deficits, he and the Republicans agreed on more deficits. So we went in the wrong direction for a long time. Now this reality is in our face. But nobody's serious because this is all about 2012. It's all about positioning.
All right.
We're in campaign mode every moment. Nobody runs the country. That's all it is.
So here we go again. Just sort of, are you a supporter of President Obama?
I'm a supporter of the President of the United States. He's our president. I voted for him at the beginning. I've been disappointed in the lack of clarity.
Pretty much same goes for you, Heilman.
I didn't vote for the president.
Okay.
He's a journalist.
Oh, right. I don't have any opinion.
I have lots of opinions, and I express them on the show all the time.
But that
doesn't mean I'm a supporter of either party or that I voted for the president or for John McCain.
What I'm getting at is we're getting hit a lot lately for not bringing on people who speak, you know, on behalf of the White House and really stick up for the president. But we are bringing people on, but they're not doing it as much lately, I guess is my point.
Obama supporters, we have been criticized.
I'm just trying to figure out here.
By a couple of our friends who say, oh, a lot of your people around the table, well, there's a suggestion even that we need to get more balance to our table and more Democrats, which we checked the numbers, and oh my God, it's
so over the
like
past
ten,
couple
it's
of months.
It's a 10-to-1 ratio, Democrats to Republicans, as far as guests on this show. And yet, there are a lot of people that supported the president strongly for 2 years that just don't support him anymore.
So, after what you just said, I'm just wondering what you think the president's doing right in all this.
Look, I think what he said this week actually is more correct than anything that the Republicans are saying, which is that we need a balanced approach out of this.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is that we're drifting, and he never put forward a credible way out. I think he went in the wrong direction at the start. I think the Democrats bought into this stimulus idea, which was, in my opinion, the wrong idea.
Country's on the verge of economic brain card. Debt is out of control. But, you know, we need to take a break.
That's exciting, too.
Need to take a break.
And do what?
Rest.
Talk
with our family.
Watch some baseball.
Yeah.
It'll be a fun weekend of baseball. Dr. Sachs, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm doing well.
Okay. So it's been one day since President Obama's news conference where he blasted congressional Republicans for failing to strike a deal on raising the debt ceiling. And now Republicans are striking back. The sticking point in negotiations was the Democratic push for raising taxes on the wealthy Americans. Republicans say this is not an option, slamming the president on Capitol Hill yesterday.
What I'd like to see him do is agree on the outlines of a 10-year plan.
Well, whoa.
TJ?
That was the wrong sound.
TJ, Alex. Sound. Hey, Alex, TJ.
That was Bill Clinton's.
Hey, would it be best, guys, if we just...
Hey, TJ, did my little phone call to you this morning
off.
Shake you up a little bit?
Guys?
Yeah, I was thrown off. I'm sorry.
Would you just maybe...
I apologize.
Maybe you should have started your 4th of July weekend yesterday.
I'm going to leave now.
All right. How's do that? We have the
no.
right...
Sound can you do this?
Yes,
good.
We have the right
can you
sound
do,
bite.
Do this is okay. Press the button that says I'm the right button. Can
we're
you
good
do
to go.
That?
You want me to come
are
back
you,
there?
You need help?
All right, here it is. Go.
Congress isn't going to approve hundreds of billions of dollars in tax hikes. It's simply not going to happen. The president does not seem to get it.
Not to be reckless, not to give demagogic speeches like the president gave yesterday as part of his reelection campaign. Absolutely disgraceful. He should be ashamed.
Now he says it isn't worth his time to come down and talk to Republicans. I remember when he talked to Republicans before, and all we got was a lecture. So maybe if you just take a Valium and calm down and come on down and talk to us, it might be helpful.
Did the president take a Valium?
Yes, he did.
Oh, boy. The rhetoric continued on the Senate floor.
It's even a little bit stranger than that because he put out a February budget. Then Ryan came in March with this alternative. Then the president gave a speech about yet another budget in April. Then we never saw details about it. That's the kind of drift and lack of seriousness on both sides that's
but we're hearing maybe
for
Bill
this
Clinton.
Country. And sorry about that.
I was just going to say, to Jeff's point about this being a game, this all looks to the American public like theater. Someone comes out with a plan, the other side attacks it. How snarky can you be? Go take a Valium, Mr. President. I think people who are losing their jobs, people who are struggling to make payments, want to know when the game ends and when people are going to get serious. Is that possible, John Heilman, with as far apart as these two sides are? on the core issues of taxes, on entitlement reform. Is there even a deal to be made between these two sides who don't even speak to each other?
Gosh, I don't know the answer to that question, although I can tell you that, first of all, I can say that the American people are right if they think this is all theater, and there, this is, the level of kabuki going on here is very high, and I think the answer is, to the extent anyone's going to get serious, they're only going to get serious at the absolute last minute when the deadline actually comes. And so, to me, everything that's gone on, from the way Republicans have behaved to the way the Democrat, the way the president has postured, is all kind of, you know, it's placeholders, and we're going to see in the last week of July, before this deadline comes up in August, then we're going to get serious. But to Mika's point, and I will say this not as a supporter of the president, but just as I think, as a matter of fact, to Jeffrey's point about arithmetic, right now, the fact that Republicans are taking the position that the White House is calling the maximalist position, which is to say they've gone from saying they wanted mostly spending cuts to now saying they will not accept any deal that has any revenue increases whatsoever. There is no arithmetic over the long haul that brings the country to fiscal sanity that does not have both entitlement reform,
right,
and increased revenues on the table. There is no way to make that math work. So right now, if you want to place the burden of responsibility, who's being most irresponsible right now? The Republicans are being most irresponsible, because it's insane to rule out an entire category of the way that fiscal policy works in America, including all tax breaks, all subsidies, all things that good conservatives who have always said that corporate welfare was a bad idea, all of a sudden, we can't talk about that either.
Okay, but
and that's just absurd.
You know, what else is absurd is having friends of this show on, Democrats, who we like very much, coming on saying we're going to have to cut subsidies for corporate jets. We're going to have to cut subsidies for oil companies. We're going to have to go after those rich people. Oh, we're going to have to raise taxes. We're going to have to put a tax on people who buy shiny cars. We're going to have to put a tax on people who have shiny poker chips that have their names engraved on it in gold. Republicans are going to kill Medicare.
That's silly talk,
And so then Willie Geist asked, hold on, let me finish my point. It's a long one.
Wow.
Then Willie Geist asks the question.
I asked Sherrod Brown yesterday.
Who we like very much.
I said, is Medicare off the table?
And to which he replied, oh, yes, it's off the table. You
what?
Can't touch it. Well, and Howard Dean, in effect, another good friend of ours, said, it's off the table. You can't touch that. That is every bit as reckless and irresponsible as saying you're not going to raise taxes.
Joe, you'll note that at the beginning of what I said was that for the long term that you need to deal with entitlements as well as deal with the revenue side. But right now the Democrats in Congress have accepted the notion that a package that they would sign on to includes three-quarters of the proportion of what would be taken out would be from the spending side. So the Democrats are at least, they're open to the notion of cutting spending. They're not just open to the notion of cutting spending. They're open to the notion of cutting spending more than the amount of revenue they would raise.
Okay.
Republicans are ruling an entire category off limits.
Here's a problem, though, too.
But it shows how much we've changed the terms of the debate in this town. And I think, Wolf, that is a great way to get to the White House now, because except for tonight, the president hasn't been very visible in the past couple of days. But he was in front of the cameras, and he came out just moments ago. I'm going to go to our White House correspondent, Dan Lothian, who is standing by now. Dan, you heard what I said. John Boehner says it's not the greatest deal. It's not the greatest deal, but it shows that we have changed the terms of the debate in this town. It certainly backed the president into a corner and put Democrats really on the defensive here, because Republicans got mostly what they want. Democrats didn't.
It is important. I mean, we were reporting this earlier, Don, where we talked about how there was concern here at the White House about whether the GOP and whether John Boehner were on board. But it's also important whether or not Democrats are on board. And the White House realizes that as well, because you have some of these progressive Democrats who are unhappy because of the issue of not having any revenue here. No taxes, they believe, on the wealthiest Americans. They're getting away with it. And yet middle class Americans and senior citizens are the ones ones who are carrying the heaviest load here. So the president still has some selling to do. Unclear, though, where Nancy Pelosi is in process.
All right, Dan Lothian, stand by.
And as the brutal debt negotiations near an end, Speaker Boehner opened up to CBS News about opposition to the deal within his own party.
You were unable to get your own caucus behind your bill a few days ago. Do you intend to remain Speaker of the House?
I do. And when you look at this final agreement that we came to with the White House, you know, I got 98% of what I wanted. I'm pretty happy.